Source control or source code management is an essential part of development process. As the team and source code grows, more and more people are working on the same piece of code. So it is imperative to have some processes or policies in place so that we can manage the source code efficiently. Irrespective of which branching model we use, we would want to have some measures implemented so that we spend lesser time managing issues like merge conflicts or broken functionalities. If you're interested in branching strategies with Git, I have a video on that and you can find the link up here. So go ahead and check that out. Azure DevOps comes up with various features which can help us implement some of these processes and policies. In today's video, we'll check what those features are and how we can use them. Welcome to Omega Codex and my name is Sanal. If you are new here, please subscribe to the channel so that you don't miss out on new videos. And if you enjoy this video, don't forget to hit the like button. We have quite a few options to cover, so stay with me till the end and let's jump into Azure DevOps to learn about these features. Today we'll look into how we can set up some processes and policies on an Azure DevOps repository. I have logged into my Azure DevOps instance. I'm using Azure DevOps Services, the online version of Azure DevOps. And I have created a project using Azure DevOps Demo Generator. So you can also use this project to play around. You can go to Azure DevOps generator.azurewebsites.net. You can sign in using your credentials and it will help you set up a demo project with which you can play around. So on this project, let's go to repository and to the branches. So branch policies basically helps you protect your important branches, and you can enforce these policies to ensure code quality and, you know, have a change management process. So the prerequisite for setting up branch policies is that you must either be a member of project administrator security group or you need to have repository level edit policy permissions. So let's look at the permissions required. You can go to project settings, repositories, security, and project administrators. You can see that you have the edit policies permissions allowed for project administrators, but if you come to contributors, it is not set and not allowed. So if we want to allow other members to have this permission, we can change it here. So let's go back to branches. To define a branch policy, we can click on this more options, the three dots on the right side, and select branch policies. So if a branch policy is set for a branch, you could see that this policy icon is set in front of the repository name. So let's go to the branch policy and understand the policies. So the first section is branch policies. Once a branch policy is set, the branch cannot be deleted and all the changes made to that branch must be made through a pull request. So let's understand each of the options. So the first one is require minimum number of reviewers. For any pull request made to the main branch, we can define how many number of reviewers or how many number of people should review the code before the pull request is accepted. The default is 2, and minimum there should be 1 reviewer and no more than 10 reviewers. The next option is allow requesters to approve their own changes. If we enable this, the person who is creating the pull request also is allowed to approve their own changes, and it would be counted into the number of minimum reviewers. Second option is prohibit the most recent pusher from approving their own changes. So by enabling this means that the most recent pusher or whoever has committed most recently, their vote also counts to the reviews. So if there are multiple people committing to that particular branch, we can, by default their vote is not counted, but you can enable this to allow their vote to be counted. The third one is allowing completion even if some reviewers vote to wait or reject. So if any of the reviewers have rejected the pull request or have asked to wait, we can still allow the completion of the pull request if the minimum number of reviewers criteria is fulfilled. So last option is when new changes are pushed, what action to be taken. So whenever a new change is put to that branch, whether it requires at least one approval on the last iteration. So if, for example, you already have the approved number of or the required number of reviewers, and a new change is being pushed because of some review comments, do we need an approval again? So if that is required, you can enable using the first option. If you want to reset all the approvals which were received previously, you can use the second option, but it doesn't reset any reject or wait votes. And the third one is resetting all the votes. So whatever votes you have received for the pull request, be it approval or rejection, everything gets reset whenever a new change is pushed. Now, the second category is check for linked work items. So if you want to link your work items to the changes being made to the repository, you can enable this option. And you can make it as required or optional. In case of optional, they just are warned that there is no linked work item, but it's not enforced, and user or the developer is free to go ahead with the pull request. It is beneficial when you want to have a traceability between your work items and the changes being made, and you want that tracking to happen. It is encouraged to have this traceability because it is helpful in future whenever you are debugging an older code, or if you are reviewing older user stories and trying to find out a change related to that user story, it is helpful in those scenarios. So it is always advisable to enable this option. The next option is check for comment resolution. So whenever a pull request is reviewed and the comments being made for the review, whether we want them to be resolved before the pull request is accepted. So if we enable this, all the comments which are made, that must be resolved before the pull request is accepted. And if we use optional, then there is just a warning. If you want to limit the merge types which we want to allow, so if this is unchecked, all merge types are allowed. But if we want to restrict to a specific merge type, then we can enable this option. So this covers from a process perspective, like what all policies are applied whenever a new change is pushed to the source branch and we are trying to merge it to the master or main branch. The next section is build validation. Build validation is about validating your code before the pull request is merged to your master branch. It can help reduce breaks and can keep your test results passing. It is a good practice to enable build validation as part of your build policies. If you have watched my previous video on Git branching strategies, I talk about how Microsoft does Git branching and what kind of policies they implement. So one of the things which they also do is build validation, and they have a good number of tests which run as part of this build validation. It doesn't involve the complete test suite, but there is a good amount of tests to give a good confidence about the code changes. So once the tests are passed, they're almost certain that it shouldn't have any problems when you merge it on master, and it shouldn't break any functionalities. It's always a good practice to enable build validation. One precondition for enabling this is you should already have a build pipeline set up in Azure DevOps. So in our case, it is already set, and our pipeline is of the same name as was our repository. So if you have multiple build pipelines, you can choose whichever you want to run. The next option is path filters. So this is useful when you want to run this build validation only when certain part of your code or certain part of your repository have changes. So as you can see here in this example, it is mentioned as web app model data.cs or web app /*. So you can also use wildcards and paths and define appropriate filters. So this way we can run it when a specific part of the repository have changes. The next is whether you want to run it automatically or manual. So if you have set it as automatic, whenever there is a change being pushed into your branch, the build would automatically trigger. Otherwise, we can also set it as manual, so you will have to come and run the build, and until and unless you run and validate the build, your pull request cannot be accepted. And the next one is requirement whether we want the build to be successful or not. So if it's optional, a build failure will not block the completion of the pull request. Build expiration is about making sure that the updates in your protected branch or your master branch does not break any changes in this PR. There are three options available here. One is immediately whenever the main is updated, after 12 hours the main is updated, and never. So once your PR is created and the build validation is completed, after that if there is a change being pushed into main, whether this build validation should be cancelled or considered as failed and it has to be rebuilt again to consider the build as valid. This is to make sure that, you know, any changes in your main branch has been considered and appropriate action has been taken. So the first one is, as mentioned, immediately as soon as there is a change in the main, your build gets invalidated. The second one creates a more balanced approach where after a certain hour, so whenever your build is validated for a certain period of time, even if there are changes being pushed into main, you consider it as fine. So this option is a compromise between, you know, always requiring and never requiring a build. This reduces the number of builds whenever your master branch has frequent updates. And never is like it's never invalidated and your build is always considered valid even if there is a change in the main branch. And then we can have a name and set up the build policy. So we can branch build, for example, we can put. The next section is status checks. So as part of build policies, we can also include statuses from other services to be considered for a pull request. So this requires an external service integration with Azure DevOps. So in this case, the external service will have to push a build status for it to be considered. Usually in this case, you will have to set up a webhook which kind of sends a notification from Azure DevOps to your external service that a PR has been created, and then an appropriate action can be taken from that external service, be it running some security validations or, you know, some other checks, and then once that is completed, maybe sending a status. And there is a PR status API which is available as part of this, which can be used by that external service to push in the statuses. So as of now, I don't have anything implemented here, so I don't have anything to set. Probably I'll cover it in a different video where we can set up this external service and push statuses into build branch policies. The next one is automatically including reviewers. So in this feature, whenever some changes are being pushed into the branch, we can have reviewers automatically included as part of the process. So we can select the users existing here. So you can add reviewers who are part of your Azure DevOps user list. We can add those reviewers here, or you can even add groups as part of it, and you can have the policy requirement as optional or required. So whenever this is set to optional, though they are added as reviewers, their approval is optional. So they may or may not approve, but then they are added automatically as reviewers. But if it is set to required, then their approval is required for this PR to be considered. Again, this is similar to the filter section we had in build validation, where we can enable this automatic inclusion of reviewers whenever specific folders are affected. So it's the same path filter. So we can define absolute paths or wildcards, and whenever there are changes in those sections, then only these reviewers are added. So this is particularly useful when, suppose you have some core functionality which was developed long ago and very limited amount of people who have knowledge about that in your team, which is a very common scenario in teams which have been working on long running projects, and there are only specific set of people who fully know about the code base and or some specific core parts of the application. And whenever there is a change in those sections, you want these people to have a look and review what changes is being made. So in such scenarios, this is helpful. You can add them as automatic reviewers and mention the filter here. Again, allow requesters to approve their own changes. So if the reviewer and the one who is pushing the changes are same, it is helpful in those scenarios. So that covers all the features available as part of build policies and settings, which we can enable and we can use to set up a process for our source code management. Now, there can be scenarios or situations where you want to override this setting. So by default, when we set these things up, these are like mandatory conditions. But in specific scenarios where we want to override the settings, for example, we have set up reviewers and that reviewer is not available for some particular reason and we have to complete this review, but it has been reviewed by other people and we are sure that, you know, there are no issues and we can go ahead with the merge. So by default, we cannot override those settings. So in this case, for overriding build policy permissions, there is a permission setting in repositories security section. We can come to project administrators and there are two policies or two permissions which we can use. The first one is bypass policies when completing pull requests. So this one is to override the build policies. So if the pull request is already reviewed and, you know, all required conditions are met, but for some reason one of the parameters is not satisfied or there is some situation where we want to override this, we can give this permission to a specific user, a group of users. So like in this case, for project administrators, I can allow this and all the project administrators would be able to bypass the policy for completing a pull request. The next one is bypassing policies when pushing. So by default, when a branch policy is enabled for a branch, we cannot directly commit to that particular branch. We cannot push changes to that branch. It has to come through a pull request. So if we want to allow it for a specific set of users, we can allow this and they will be able to push directly to the master branch or wherever the branch policy is applied. This way, using branch policies and these permission settings, we can implement a process for source code management and ensure that, you know, there are minimum issues with repositories and minimum cases of merge conflicts, build failures, and, you know, broken functionalities. You can play with these features and see what works for you and what doesn't. If you have been using some of these features, let me know in the comment section below what and how you have been using them. Or if you are doing something different, please share that as well. Here are the book suggestions for today. The link for these books are in the description box below. I hope these books will help you in your DevOps journey. If scalability and reliability is of your interest, check out my video here on Azure Load Testing, a fully managed service from Azure, of course, for load testing. For Git branching strategies and how Microsoft does it, check my video here. Thanks for watching this video. I'll see you in the next one. Till then, adios.